Hello everyone, welcome to AVLSI lecture number 41.1. Today there is a very important topic which we are going to discuss, that is design of folded Cascode OPAMP. So without wasting any time, let us directly jump in. So the question says that we have to design a folded Cascode OPAMP with PMOS input devices for the following requirements. So first of all, maximum differential swing is 2.4 volt. Total power dissipation is given as 6 milliwatt. Further, it's given that if all the transistors have channel length of 0.5 micrometer and assume gamma is equal to zero, that is body effect is ignored, we have to also calculate the overall voltage gain. So the following NMOS and PMOS parameters are given. VTH and VTHP values are given. Lambda and lambda P values are given. Mu n Cox value, mu P Cox value is given to us for all the PMOS and NMOS transistors. Okay. So first of all, we have to draw the folded Cascode OPAMP circuit for reference. So what do you mean by design? Design means we have to determine the W by L ratio of all the transistors. So there are total of, M1 to M10. So total of 10 transistors are over here. So we have to design, we have to find the W by L ratios of all the transistors in the circuit. Additionally, we also have to calculate VB1, VB2, VB3, VB4 voltages. Fine. So let's directly begin with the design. So first of all, they have given that maximum differential swing, output swing is Vout max swing is given as 2.4 volt. So what is the maximum differential swing of a folded Cascode OPAMP? It is given as twice of VDD minus, either we can consider VOD, either we can consider this side of the transistors or that side. It means the same because they are symmetric, meaning either you can consider M5, M3, M7, M9, or you can consider M6, M4, M8 and M10, right? Along with M1 and M2. So over here, we are considering, what is the maximum differential swing? It's twice into VDD minus 4 overdrive voltages. And which overdrive voltages? Overdrive voltage of M3 transistor, M5 transistor, M7 transistor, and M9 transistor. Okay. Or you can write twice VDD minus overdrive voltage of M6, M4, M8 or M10. Anyone will do. So, twice VDD minus VOD3 plus VOD5 plus VOD7 plus VOD9 is equal to 2.4 volt. Fine. So that means VOD stands for overdrive voltage, which is VGS minus VTH value, right? So over here we have VOD plus VOD5, VOD3 plus VOD5 plus VOD7 plus VOD9 is equal to VDD minus 1.2, right? So 2 we have divided with 2.4, that becomes 1.2. And here we have taken VDD on that side. So that becomes VDD minus 2 volt. And VDD is given as around 3 volt. So 3 minus 1.2, that will be 1.8 volt, right? So that means these four overdrive voltages values should be total equal to 1.8 volt. Now we have to decide on the values of all these four overdrive voltages, that is VOD3, VOD5, VOD7, and VOD9. So we will assign VOD7 and VOD9 to be larger than VOD3, right? And VOD5. Why? Because M7 and M9 transistors are PMOS transistors, right? So if you see carefully, M7 and M9 transistors are PMOS transistors and M3 and M5 are my NMOS transistors. So definitely the value of VOD of M7 and M9 has to be greater than, the overdrive voltage for M3 and M5 transistors. Why? Because your PMOS transistor have a smaller mu P Cox value compared to mu N Cox value. As you can see, it's almost 3 times smaller. Mu P Cox value is 3 times smaller than mu N Cox value over here, right? And what is the formula for VOD? VOD is nothing but VGS minus VTH, that is twice ID, divided by square root, I mean, mu and cox w by l, you know, the whole raised to half is missing. No problem about it, but it's basically VOD is inversely proportional to mu and cox, right? So over here, if you have mu p cox value, your VOD has to be a larger value, because in the denominator, if you have a lower value, then VOD will be larger. So that's why your VOD 7 and VOD 9 has to be larger than VOD 3 and VOD 5. Correct? So let's say your VOD 7 and VOD 9 is 0.55 volt. So your overdrive voltage for 7 and 9 is 0.55 volt. Now, we have to decide between which value of overdrive voltage for M3 or M5 will be higher. Now, M5 needs to carry large overdrive voltage. Why it is so? So let's see that now. So in the circuit, if you see carefully, your M5 transistor carries a more current compared to M3 transistor. So M3 transistor will carry current ID3, whereas M5 transistor will carry the current ISS by 2, also ISS. I mean, it will also carry the current ISS by 2 and ID3, right? So definitely the current flowing through M5 transistor is greater than that of M3 transistor. So here we have written over here, ID5 is basically ISS by 2 plus ID3, whereas current flowing through M3 is just ID3. So therefore, we require a larger VOD for M5, because as you can see, VOD is directly proportional to square root of twice ID. So whichever transistor is having a higher ID value, that will have a higher overdrive voltage. Correct? So that's why we will consider the overdrive voltage of M5 to be greater than M3. So let us assume that overdrive voltage for M5 is 0.4. So overdrive voltage for VOD3 will be 0.3. Now, why it is 0.3? Because VOD 7 and VOD 9 we have already assigned as 0.55. So twice of 0.55 will be 1.1. Now, VOD 5 will be 0.4. So 1.1 plus 0.4, that will be 1.5. And we have a total maximum swing to be equal. I mean, this all the addition of all the four overdrive voltages should be 1.8. Right? So therefore, your VOD3 will be 0.3 volt. So this is how we have to distribute the values of the overdrive voltages, right? And also remember, the overdrive voltages will be symmetric for, so basically your, M5 and M6 overdrive voltages will be similar. M3 and M4 overdrive voltages will be similar. M7 and M8 will have similar overdrive voltage. M9 and M10 will have a similar overdrive voltage, right? So, yeah, and also the overdrive voltage for, this M1 and M2 are PMOS transistors, right? And PMOS transistors, we have already assumed the overdrive voltage to be 0.55. So we'll assume it to be 0.55 only, VOD1, okay? Now, they have given over, they have given us the value of power dissipation total. Let's see that. Total power dissipation is given as 6 milliwatt, right? So what is the power dissipation? Power dissipation is nothing but voltage into current. So what is the total current flowing through the circuit, right? So the total current flowing through the circuit will be ID5 plus ID6 into VDD. Okay, that's the total current flowing in the circuit into the total voltage, that is VDD. Why not ID3 and ID4? Because ID3 and ID4 are getting added to ISS1 and ISS2. Right? And what is ISS1? ID5. And ISS2 is ID6. So therefore, we can write over here, ID5 and ID6 are similar because the circuit is symmetric. So therefore, we can write total power dissipation is 6 milliwatt, which is equal to VDD into ID5 plus ID6, right? And they are equal. So it will be ID5 or ID6 will be equal to 6 milliwatt divided by 3. What is 3? VDD value and divided into 2. So 6 milli divided by 6 will be 1 milliampere. Okay. So your value of ID5 and ID6 will be equal to 1 milliampere of current. Okay. So we got the value of ID6 and ID5. Correct. Now, we will calculate W by L of phi So we know the value of drain current of phi, that is ID phi, is given as half mu n C ox W by L of phi into VGS phi minus VTH phi the whole square into 1 plus lambda phi into VDS phi, right? Now from here, VGS phi minus VTH phi is nothing but VOD phi, right? And VDS phi is also VOD phi, correct? So what's the value of ID phi? ID phi is basically 1 milliampere. So your W by L of phi will be twice ID phi divided by mu n C ox into VOD phi square plus 1 plus lambda in VOD phi, right? So we have assumed the value of VOD phi to be around 0.4 and ID phi is 1 milliampere. Mu n C ox value is 134 micro and lambda n value is 0.1, right? And VOD phi value is 0.4. So if you plug in all the values, you will get W by L of phi as equal to 89.54. Okay, that will be approximated as 90 by 1, right? And your M5 and M6 transistors are symmetric, right? Because their VGS values are same. And if they are matched together, we can say that W by L of 5 will be equal to W by L of 6, which is 90 by 1. Now, you know the length. All the transistors length will be equal to 0.5 micrometer. So what will be the width of M5 and M6? 90 into 0.5 micrometer, that will be 45 micrometer, right? So your W by L ratio will be 45 micrometer of 5 and 6 will be W by L of 5 equal to W by L of 6 will be 45 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer, right? And now next step. So this is how we have calculated W by L of 6 and W by L of 5. Next, we assume that the current flowing through M1 and M2 transistor is equal to 0.5, right? So that means your ISS value will be 1 milliampere because ISS gets equally split into M1 and M2, right? So if ID1 and ID2 is equal to 0.5, your value of ID3 and ID4 is also 0.5 milliampere. Why? Because ISS1 will be equal to ID3 plus ISS by 2 and ISS by 2 is 0.5. ISS1 is actually 1 milliampere. So ID3 also will be 0.5 milliamperes. So basically ID9, ID7, ID3 all will be equal to 0.5 milliamperes. Similarly, ID4, ID8, ID10 all will be equal to 0.5 milliampere along with ID1 and ID2. Correct? So that's what we have written over here, right? ID1 to 2 is 0.5 milliamperes. So ID3 and ID4 is also 0.5. Now M9, M7 and M3 are in series. So ID9, ID7 and ID3 also will be 0.5 milliamperes. Similarly, M10, M8 and M4 are in series. So all of them will be equal to ID10 will be equal to ID8 will be equal to ID4, which will be equal to 0.5 milliamperes of current. Correct? So similarly, we can write W by L of phi. We have written that W by L of phi is equal to twice ID phi divided by mu n C ox VOD phi square plus 1 plus lambda in VOD phi. Similarly, we can write W by L of 1. Now remember, W by L of 1 is of PMOS transistor, right? So we can write it as twice ID1 divided by mu p C ox VOD 1 square into 1 plus lambda p VOD 1, right? So we have the value of ID1, we have the value, we know the value of mu p C ox value. VOD1 value, we have assumed it to be 0.55, correct? So, and lambda p value is 0.2. So if you plug in all these values in the calculator, you will get W by L of 1 as 77.66. So we approximate it to the next near integer, which is 71. So W by L of 1 and W by L of 2 should be same because M1 and M2 are assumed to be symmetric. So W by L of 1 is equal to W by L of 2, which is equal to 78:1. But the length of all the transistors is 0.5 micrometer. So W1 equal to W2 should be equal to 75 into 0.5 micrometer, which will be 39 micrometer. So width of M1 and M2 is 39 micrometer. So their W by L ratio will be 39 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer, right? So far we have calculated W by L ratio for M5 and M6 and M1 and M2. Now let's proceed forward. On the similar lines, we can calculate W by L ratio for M3 transistor and M4 transistor. Their W by L ratio will be matched because M3 and M4 transistor are considered to be matched. So let's find out W by L of 3. So W by L of 3 is twice ID3 divided by, it's an NMOS transistor, right? M3 and M4. So twice ID3 divided by mu n Cox VOD3 square into 1 plus lambda in VOD3. So VOD3 we have assumed to be 0.3, right? And rest all the values are available. Lambda n is 0.1. Mu n Cox is 134 micro. And your, the value of ID3 is given as around 0.5 milliamperes. As we have assumed it to be 0.5 milliamperes. So your W by L of 3 comes out to be 80.37. So if it is 80.5, less than 80.5, we consider it a lower value. That is 80:1. So W by L of 3 will be equal to W by L of 4, which is equal to 80/1, assuming that M3 and M4 are matched transistors. But the channel length of all the transistors would be 0.5 micrometer. So therefore, the width of M3 and M5 will be W3 and W4, which will be equal to 80/0.5 micrometer, which is 40 micrometer. So W by L of 3 and W by L of 4 will be equal to 40 micrometer/0.5 micrometer. Fine. So next we'll go to W by L of 7. So W by L of 7 will be twice ID7 divided by, it's a PMOS transistor. So twice ID7 divided by UP Cox VOD7 into 1 plus lambda P into VOD7. So your VOD7 value is 0.55. We have assumed it earlier. So all the other values are available to us. Lambda P is 0.2. So if you work it out, you will get W by L of 7 will be equal to 77.66. That will be 78:1. So which will be same as your W by L of 8, W by L of 9, and W by L of 10. So M7 to M8 are matched transistors, right? So we are assuming that M8 and M9 and M10 are all matched transistors. So your the W by L ratio will be same. So we can write, but the channel length is given as 0.5 micrometer. So the width of M7, M8, M9, and M10, which is W7, W8, W9, and W10 will be equal to 78/0.5 micrometer, which will be 39 micrometer. So therefore, W by L of 7 will be equal to W by L of 8, will be equal to W by L of 9, will be equal to W by L of 10, which will be equal to 39 micrometer/0.5 micrometer. Now, let's proceed ahead. So now we have calculated actually the W by L ratios of almost all the transistors. Now we will calculate your, the VB1, VB2, VB3 and VB4 values, right? Now, VB2, what is VB2 from the diagram? So VB2 from the diagram over here is same as your VGS5, correct? And so VB2 will be equal to VGS5. According to the diagram. And what is your VOD5? What is your VOD5? VOD5 is nothing but VGS5 minus VTH5. So what will be VGS5? VGS5 will be VOD5 plus VTH5. So that is your VGS5. So your VB2 is nothing but VOD5 plus VTH5. And VOD5 is nothing but 0.4. And VTH5, M5 transistor is NMOS transistor. So its value of VTH5 is 0.7. So 0.4 plus 0.7 will be 1.1 volt, right? So we have calculated the value of VB2, which is the biasing required for biasing M5 and M6. So VB2 is coming out to be 1.1 volt. Now, let's focus on calculating VB1. So what is VGS3? VGS3 can be written as VG3 minus VS3. So what is VG3 from the diagram? VG3 is nothing but VB1. Correct? VG3 is nothing but VB1. And what is VS3? VS3 is nothing but overdrive voltage of M5 transistor. Correct? Because VS3 is nothing but VGS3 minus, it is nothing but VDS5. Okay? And your VDS5 is nothing but overdrive voltage of M5 transistor. So over here we have written VGS3 will be equal to VB1 minus VOD5. Right? So VB1 will be equal to VGS3 plus VOD5. So what is VOD3? VOD3 is VGS3 minus VTH3. Okay, so your VGS3 value will be, your VGS3 value will be VOD3 plus VTH3, correct? So we substitute the value of VGS3 as VOD3 plus VTH3. So VB1 will be VOD3 plus VTH3 plus VOD5. So VOD3 value is 0.3. We have assumed it to be 0.3. VTH3 is 0.7 and VOD5 is 0.4. So this value comes out to be 1.4 volt. So your VB1 value should be, that is the biasing for M3 and M4 should be 1.4 volt. Okay. So next we focus on finding the value of VB4. Okay. So the value of VB4, first of all, let us understand what is VB4. So VB4 is the biasing for M9 and M10 transistor, right? So let's find the value of VB4. So over here we have VSG9. So VSG9 is basically VS9 minus VG9. Okay. So let's see what is VS9 and VG9. So from here, VS9 is nothing but VDD and VG9 is nothing but VB4. Okay. So your value of VSG9 will be VDD minus VB4. Correct. So, and what is your VOD9? Your overdrive voltage for M9 transistor will be VSG9 minus mod of VT9. Correct. So your value of VB4 will be equal to VDD minus, value of VB4 will be equal to VDD minus VSG9. So what is VSG9? VSG9 is nothing but VOD9 plus VTH9, mod of VTH9. So your VOD9 is 0.55. Your VTH9 is 0.8 because it's for a PMOS transistor. So VB4 value will be 3 minus 0.55 plus 0.8. That is equal to 1.65. So your VB4 value, which is the biasing for M9 and M10 transistor, will be 1.65. Correct? Now, lastly, we'll calculate the biasing voltage for M7 and M8 transistor, which is VB3. So what is the value of VSG7? So VSG7 is VS7 minus VG7. So what is VS7? VS7 is nothing but your VDD minus overdrive voltage of M9 transistor, right? And what is VG7? VG7 is VB3. So VSG7 is VDD minus overdrive voltage for M9, that is VOD3, minus VB3. Okay, so we will calculate now what is VB3. So VB3 will be VDD minus mod of, VDD minus overdrive voltage for M9, which is VOD9, minus VSG7. Correct. So we'll calculate what is VSG7. So your VS7 is nothing but VDD minus mod of VOD9, right? That we have already considered. So what is the VOD7 will be given by? VOD7 is your overdrive voltage for M7, which will be given by VSG7 minus mod of VTH7. So your VSG7 is equal to VOD7 plus VTH7. So that is what exactly we'll substitute VSG7 as. It will be minus of, so VB3 will be VDD minus mod of VOD9 minus mod of VOD7 minus mod of VTH7. So 3 minus VOD9 is 0.55, VOD7 is also 0.55, and VTH7 is 0.8. So 3 minus 1.1, that is 0.55 minus 0.55 will be 1.1. And minus 0.8. So VB3 will come out to be 1.1 volt. Okay. So the VB3 was the biasing for M7 and M8 transistor. So it came out to be 1.1. Now, your design will be complete if they haven't asked you the overall voltage gain. If they ask you the overall voltage gain, then you have to calculate further, or else your design will be completed over here. Right. So, but they have asked us to find the overall voltage gain. So the overall voltage gain of this folded cascode op-amp is given by AV will be approximately equal to minus of GM1 into GM7 into RO7 into RO9 parallel to GM3 into RO3 into RO1 parallel to RO5. So we have to quickly calculate all these terms and find out the overall voltage gain. So GM1 is twice ID1 divided by VSG1 minus mod of VTH1, right? Your VSG1, why we write it VSG1? Because it's a PMOS transistor. Okay, so here we have GM1 will be twice of ID1, and in a denominator, this VSG1 minus VTH1 mod of VTH1 will be VOD1, right? And VOD1 value is 0.55. So GM1 value will be twice into 0.5 milli divided by 0.55, which will come out to be 1.8182 milliampere per volt. Next, we calculate GM7. So GM7 will be twice ID7 divided by VOD7. So VOD7 is again 0.55. So again, the value of GM7 will be 1.8182 milliampere per volt. Next, we calculate GM3. So GM3 is twice ID3 divided by VOD3. So VOD3 is 0.3, and twice ID3 is basically 1 milliampere only. So 1 milliampere divided by 0.3, which will be 3.33 milliampere per volt. Okay, next we have to calculate RO7, which is equal to RO9. So RO7 will be 1 upon lambda p into ID7. Lambda p value is 0.2, ID7 value is around 0.5 milli. So RO7 will be equal to RO9, which will be equal to 10 kilo. Now let us calculate RO1. So RO1 is actually again a PMOS transistor. So RO1 is 1 upon lambda 1 into ID1. Lambda 1 value is 0.2. ID1 value is 0.5, so RO1 will be equal to 10 kilo. Next, we calculate RO3. So RO3 will be 1 upon lambda 3 into ID3, and M3 transistor is NMOS, so lambda 3 value will be 0.1. So your value of RO3 will, and ID3 is 0.5 milli, so RO3 will be equal to 20 kilo. Next, we'll calculate RO5. We have to be careful for RO5. So RO5 is associated with M5 transistor. So it will be 1 upon lambda 5 into ID5. Remember, your ID5 current is 1 milliampere, not 0.5 milliampere, right? So it will be 1 divided by 0.1 into 1 milliampere. So that will be 10 kilo ohms. So RO5 will be 10 kilo ohms. Now we have all the values of ROs, right? So we have to calculate RO1 parallel to RO5, which will be 10K parallel to 10K, which will be 5 kilo ohms. Now we have to find the multiplication factor GM3 RO3 into RO1 parallel to RO5. So after calculating, we will get this value as 333 into 10 raised to 3. Next, we have to calculate GM7 into RO7 into RO9, which will come out to be 181.82 into 10 raised to 3. So please calculate this and verify. If you get any other answer than this, please write in the comment section. Right. So we have already found out the product now. So AV is basically minus of GM1. GM1 value is 1.8182 milli. We know this product now, GM7, RO7 and RO9, which is 181.82 into 10 raised to 3. Parallel to, we also know this product now. It is 333 into 10 raised to 3. So if you take the parallel of both, you will get 117.6 K. And you multiply it with 1.8982 into 10 is to minus 3. So this product will come out to be 213.83, right? Which we can approximate it equal to 214. So the voltage gain, overall voltage gain for the folded cascode op-amp for the design circuit is 214, right? So therefore, finally, we draw the design circuitry, right? So if you look carefully over here, we have written the W by L ratio of all the transistors over here. So let's look into detail. So ISS value will be 1 milliampere, correct? Your W by L ratio for M1 and M2 is 78 micrometer divided by 1 micrometer. Your W by L ratio for M7 to M10 transistor will be M7, M8, M9 and M10 transistor will be 78 micrometer divided by 1 micrometer. Your 0.5 milliamperes of current flows through them. M3 and M4 transistor will have a W by L ratio of 80 micrometer divided by, actually it should be 0.5 micrometer, correct? Let me check it out. Yeah, so instead of writing 80 by 1 micrometer, we could have written 40 micrometer by 0.5 micrometer. So we'll change that, right? So basically in this, what will be the change? Instead of writing, because the channel length is given as 0.5, so your width will be half everywhere. Okay, so the new values will be 49, this will be around 39 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer, right? And again, all these values, M7 to M10 transistor, the W bell ratio will be 39 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer, because that's the value given to us. And your W bell ratio for M3 and M4 will be 40 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer. Here I have taken as LS 1 micrometer, but in the numerical it's given as 0.5. So we have taken, we have to take the value of W as half. Then only this will become 40 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer. Similarly, W bell ratio for M5 and M6 is basically 45 micrometer divided by 0.5 micrometer, right? And also the value of VB2 is 1.1. The value of VB1 is 1.4 volt. VB3 is 1.1 and VB4 is 1.65. Okay, so this completes the design. So after you complete the design, write the W bell ratio for all the transistors along with the biasing voltage. Okay, so with this, we complete the design of folded cascode op-amp. So that's it for this session. Next time, we will start with two-stage op-amp. So until then, have a good day and thank you.